This function takes two arguments, checks if they're equal, and if so, it returns some combination of them. Otherwise, it returns another combination. We compile it for Risc-v. Argument A comes in a 0 register. B argument comes in a 1 register. We have two groups of 4 instructions. The first group, we load integer 7 into A5, divide a 0, which is a, by 7, and subtract b. So these 4 instructions are implementing that return. The next 4 instructions do almost the same. Load 3 to A5, divide a by 3, and add a1, which is b. So this group implements that return. The first one, BEQ, stands for branch if equal. It compares a and b. If they are equal, the branch is taken, so we jump here, which is this return. If a and b are not equal, we don't jump anywhere. The processor just fetches the next instruction and we proceed to that return. In other words, the branch is not taken. This kind of branch instructions, which are jumping or not jumping depending on some condition, are called conditional branches. What happens inside the processor? Every CPU instruction goes through several execution stages. The program counter points to the current instruction. The processor fetches it from memory and increments the program counter to point to the next instruction. The next stage is decoding. So we divide A0 by A5. The next step is the arithmetic unit, so the division is actually happening. And we also have a condition check for branch instructions. Next, we might need to read or write memory, but division doesn't use it. And again, we have some program counter routing for branch instructions. And the last step is to write the result back to the target register. So every CPU clock cycle, the instruction goes to the next stage. Let's go back to the beginning. This time, we start with the very first instruction, branch if equal. We fetch it from memory. When the first stage is done, the instruction goes to the second stage. And these transistors are not in use anymore, they are just waiting. Can we fetch the next instruction? Yes, let's do that, why to wait? It means that at the same time, these transistors are executing the first instruction, while these transistors are executing the next one. This approach is called instruction pipelining, and it's been in use since the 70s. Smaller the pipeline stage, higher the processor frequency. Nowadays every CPU is pipelined. Let's take one more step and fetch the next instruction. And now, at the execution stage, the processor is finally comparing A0 and A1. And they might be equal. The branch should be taken. Which means that we jump here and execute these instructions. These two already fetched instructions are halfway through the pipeline, but they belong to the code path we don't go. We don't need them anymore, and we have to drop them. We lost 2 CPU cycles fetching wrong instructions. And now we need to fetch instructions from the correct path. This situation is very unfortunate, but we are calculating the actual condition very late in the pipeline. By this moment, we might have already fetched a few instructions from the wrong path. It becomes even worse if the pipeline has many stages, which is the case for today's CPUs. Conditions are still checked very late in the pipeline. If we go the wrong path, we waste even more CPU cycles. Can we guess or maybe even predict the correct path at the very beginning and go the correct way? We can try to build a hardware block about it, but first let's try to estimate some statistics. Branch if equal. If this branch is totally random, with 50-50 chances of being taken, we are in trouble. How can we predict? But the processor is usually running some meaningful code. And the real code has some patterns. An average loop probably iterates several times, like this one. This branch is taken several times and not taken only once during the exit. We also might have error checks, which are probably not happening very often. So it could be that each specific branch is quite biased towards being taken or not taken. We can try to build a hardware block right in the beginning of the pipeline. While running the program, it will collect some statistics for every branch instruction it meets. When we see a branch instruction for the first time, we remember its address and whether it was taken or not. The next time we execute the same branch instruction, we already can do a prediction like, aha, the last time it was taken, so maybe this time it will also be taken. I will call this approach the same as the last time. This extremely simple idea might actually work quite well, but we can try to make something more advanced. Let's quickly go back to the loop example. We use our prediction strategy the same as the last time. We do the first iteration and the first jump. The prediction is set to taken, so all the further 98 jumps will be predicted correctly. Until we exit this loop, we mispredict here for the first time. And the prediction changes to not taken. Our loop is finished, but the next time we come to that loop, the first jump will also be mispredicted. After that, we flip our prediction to taken and we successfully predict the next 98 iterations. So the first and the last iterations are always mispredicted. We have two mispredictions per loop. In that case, branch is always taken, except once in a while it is not. If we don't flip the prediction here, we will have only one misprediction per loop, which is two times better. So if we see just a single misprediction, we don't flip it. We flip only in case of two in a row mispredictions. This approach apparently works quite well. In books we can find benchmark results of this twice in a row branch predictor like this. Sometimes it is very accurate. My processor also has a branch predictor. Its algorithm is hidden from us and it is actually a very important company secret. But it exposes a counter of mispredicted branches. We can check how many branches are mispredicted while I'm using my web browser. I'm attaching the perf tool to its PID and this time I got 5%. I really want to try some prediction strategies myself, but branch predictor is a pure hardware block. We don't have any access to it. I need something that executes code and reports me the full trace of all branches being executed. Having that trace, I will be able to imitate some strategy and run this strategy through this real trace to see how accurate the strategy is. Real CPUs just execute instructions. They don't expose an instruction-by-instruction trace. So we need a software CPU simulator. This is some Risc-v simulator from GitHub. It has a big while true loop where it fetches instructions one by one and simulates all pipeline stages. To decode an operation, it checks certain bits of the binary instruction. Branch if equal instruction in binary form looks like this. This is its bit format from the instruction set. To recognize that this binary instruction is branch if equal and nothing else, we need to check opcode and funct 3 bits. Here we see all the possible conditional branches. Now to the execution stage. We see a big switch block. All operations are here. This is our branch if equal. It checks if operands are equal, and if so, changes the program counter. And this is a perfect place where we can print the information for our log. But I don't want to use a Risc-v simulator. I want to use Python. When the Python interpreter runs this function, it actually transforms our Python code into bytecode instructions. We will not go into its details, but we can think about it like this. We have an imaginary or virtual CPU, which can execute instructions like this. And the Python interpreter is a simulator of this imaginary CPU. So we are not simply running this Python function, we are simulating the behavior of this virtual CPU. Look here, pop jump if false. It is a conditional jump. It takes, pops the result of this comparison from the stack, and if it is false, it jumps to the address 16, which is this return. So, let's collect a huge trace of conditional jumps inside the Python interpreter. Let's download and build a Python interpreter named cpython from GitHub. I run this freshly built Python executable, and it works. Let's look at the source code and add prints to the conditional jumps. In this file, cpython handles bytecode. This is a switch case for opcodes. And here it includes a big file with all the instructions. This instruction, that instruction, and so on. Let's find pop jump if false. Here it is. Now back to our example. Pop jump if false goes right after the compare instruction. It takes the result of the comparison from the stack top. If cond is false, it sets up the flag to 1, And the program counter jumps only if the flag is 1, which means that this conditional jump is taken. We can print our trace right here. We print the instruction name, its address, and whether it was taken or not. Python has only 4 conditional jumps. They look almost the same, and I added prints to every single one. Let's build it. Now, if I run a Python program, for example this PyPerformance benchmark, I will get this output, the trace we wanted. Let's collect it to the file and clean from the regular output. We have a 5GB trace file. I open it with pandas and this is how it looks. A full record of 147 million conditional jumps. How many of them are taken and how many are not? Almost 63% are taken. Next, for our convenience, we extract zeros and ones from the taken column, so I have a column of integers which is easy to work with. Now let's take a look at some statistics of our conditional jump trace. For each jump instruction, we will count how many times we executed and how many times the jump was actually taken and not taken. In total, we have 97,000 jump instruction spots. That one, for example, was executed 196 times and taken 49 times out of 196. Let's sort it and find the most popular ones. This jump instruction was executed 2.4 million times, as well as these 10 jumps. Let's take a look at the distribution. The scale is very bad. The 11 most popular branches are somewhere over there, but we are not able to see them. Let's use a log scale for a vertical axis. This is better. This picture means that we have 11 conditional jumps, which were executed about 2.4 million times each. One jump was executed around 2 million times. Three jumps were executed about 1.5 million times, and so on. Most of the branches are on the left, executed not so many times. Let's go back to the linear scale, but this time I will multiply each histogram pin by the number of jump instruction executions, so we see the actual impact of each group. Remember that in total we have 147 million conditional jumps executed. The 11 hottest branches are making around 26 million executions. 20 million here, 25 million here. The remaining 70 million are a bit more spread. We were expecting before that because of natural patterns in the code, like loops and error checks, each individual jump might be quite biased towards being taken or not. Let's try to look at the distribution of the probability of being taken. In our trace, we have about 97,000 conditional jump instructions, which were executed 147 million times in total. This picture shows that 30,000 of them were almost always not taken and about 46,000 were almost always taken. So our hypothesis seems to be correct for our trace. Conditional jumps are quite biased. Even if we exclude extreme left and extreme right bins and also exclude very rare branches, we still have a kinda nice curve in the distribution. Which means that these branches also might have some tendencies towards being taken or not. Let's try some strategies. With help of Stack Overflow and my wife, I managed to create a dictionary that contains a branch history array for each address. Similar to the table we discussed before. Each address now has its complete jump history. The first strategy, the same as the last time. This function takes the branch history array for one specific address. The first prediction is simply the first array entry. We iterate through every element, compare it with the prediction and update statistics. And we set the prediction to be the same as the previous result. We run this function for every address and collect prediction accuracy. With the same as before strategy, we made 93% accuracy. The second strategy we discussed was to change the prediction only in case of 2 mistakes in a row. So here we flip the prediction only in case of 2 in a row predictions wrong. It gives us a bit better accuracy, 94.2%. In our branch trace, we had 97,000 different jump instruction addresses, and we collected a branch history for every single one. But a real transistor table is made of transistors, and in most cases we cannot afford it to be that big. It is usually limited to a few thousand entries. One way to index such entries is to take the last few bits of the address. For example, 12 bits gives us 4096 combinations, but it means that some branches which have the same 12 bits of the address will end up in the same row and their branch history will be messed together. We just hope that it doesn't happen very often. Prediction of being taken or not is not the only thing we need to predict. Imagine this pipeline, and we have this branch of equal instruction. We want to make a prediction and start fetching instructions from the correct path. But we have no idea where the correct path starts. Jump offset is encoded in binary form, so the target address will be decoded later. To not waste those CPU cycles, we can try to remember where this particular branch instruction jumped the last time. So this time we can start fetching instructions from the same place. For each branch instruction, we will remember its target jump address. So we injected some prints into the Python bytecode interpreter to trace branch instructions. And we even made a few experiments with some branch prediction strategies. I believe that experimenting is the best way to really learn things. And Brilliant is a great help here. With thousands of interactive lessons in math, data analysis, programming and AI, you will grasp ideas and build a solid knowledge foundation. When I learn something, I really like it when I understand every single step. With Brilliant, you will not miss any puzzle piece. An award-winning team of teachers, researchers and professionals from MIT, Caltech, Microsoft, Google and more will help you to build the understanding from the ground up with a lot of hands-on problem solving, which is much more effective than just watching lecture videos. Brilliant recently launched a ton of new data science content. With its help, you will not only be able to experiment with branch prediction strategies, but also visualize real-world data from sources like Airbnb, Spotify, Starbucks and more, to see trends, get insights and make better informed decisions. To try everything Brilliant has to offer for free for a full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/gaminglamp or scan the QR code on screen. Or you can click the link in the description. You'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription.